Okay, I try to give a variety of videos here on this channel. It's sort of an alternative to popular media, right? To come here, TV, you don't have to watch TVs, movies, radio, whatever. You can. It's an alternative. You can say, you know what? I prefer to spend some, audio visual focus on this. So I'm putting in, a variety to keep it interesting here. The topic of today's video is let's give Jesus a fair hearing. Let's give Jesus a fair hearing. Interesting, huh? In my opinion, Jesus feels we have not given him a fair hearing at all. And I would agree with this. Not at all. And so I feel like I've just always felt like, hey, I want to give Jesus a fair hearing so I know, really know what he has to say. I'd rather, I don't feel I'm getting it from the books and the Bible and Christianity and this and this and that. I don't feel that I'm getting really what Jesus really has to say. I feel I'm listening sort of to someone else and certain something that is just, has taken it and watered it down and changed it. So I've made it my purpose in life to try to give Jesus a fair hearing. So, I continue this every day. Every day. This morning, I had a tremendous session of just trying to understand truth and trying to get a sense of what is Jesus really saying? Is he saying this? Is he saying that? Jesus doesn't try to force feed us, but so we have to be willing to look at it. And I made so many breakthroughs. I've just kind of been in the wow today. I wish I could keep going, but you know how the wow comes up, and you just kind of say, whoa. It's kind of like today I ran today, and after you finish running, you kind of feel like, well, I did a great workout, but I don't really feel like going out and running again. So it's hard enough to get started running once, but twice. After this half marathon I witnessed yesterday, this man was going in a hotel that had run the marathon. He had still had his number on and running shorts and everything. And I just went up to him and said, "Hey, how do you feel?" And he goes, "Sore, really, really sore." And I'm telling you, looking at those people running the marathon, I was shocked. I mean, half marathon, 13 some odd miles. I was thinking I was going to look at athletes. It's just the opposite. It's a bunch of old people, really, and they're all out of shape. I mean, it's a bunch of dumpy, out of shape housewives and office workers. And I mean, just watch. I didn't want to take the people's, video of the actual people so much. It's okay, but I wanted to emphasize, the feet and stuff going horizontal. But you could have seen. I mean. Obese people you would never think could run at all. So many, 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 many. I hardly saw anyone that looks like an athlete at all. They were all just, oh, straining and ah. And yet somehow they were doing it. It was so astonishing. So, it just shows us that if we want to give a fair hearing to Jesus, it's going to be difficult. But we could do it if we want to. Just. You take somebody just oh, dumpy, lumpy, looks like they couldn't, and they're running a half marathon. I don't know where they get it. It's just the will. It's the will. It's the thing to do. It's just like it's some sort of personal goal that they have in life, just to show, I'm not this just, dump, this dumpy, out of shape person. I ran a half marathon. It's something that there's something within them. I really was impressed by what I saw and shocked. I couldn't run a half marathon. It's hard enough to run a mile. Now they would stop and walk a little ways. And I understand that. I feel kind of motivated. I mean, it was really inspiring in some way. I know, it's not that big of a goal. I don't see it as I think we have a bigger goal here, of course. But the principle is that. If you really want to do something, you're going to be able to do it for the most part, except making illusions true and get rid of them. That's one thing we cannot do. And that's what, of course, what we're trying to do. And we, our failures have us project failure. And this is the issue. We're trying to do the impossible. And then blaming ourselves when we, you know, can't do it. And then feeling so much self-condemnation, we then project that on others and think that they need, you know, to be perfect. If they were just perfect, we'd be happy. So giving Jesus a fair hearing is like, you know, it's like running a marathon. I mean, it's not easy. Let's put it this way. It's not going to be easy for anyone. It has not been easy for me. That's to say the least. Even though I felt like I could do it, you know, it's like saying, well, I think I can run a marathon. I said, well, yeah, I probably could train and maybe someday possibly do it. Yeah. But it certainly wouldn't be easy at all. But again, what are our goals in life? What are our goals in life? Why give Jesus a fair hearing? Well, I can say, having done this my entire life, really, but very intensely for going on 39 years, I would say it's very much worth it. It's like saying to somebody, you know what, going to Yosemite National Park is really worth it. Going to Grand Canyon is really worth it. There are certain things, you know, that if you go there and say, well, okay, I'll go there. And you go there and you say, wow, you know, it really was worth it. It's really, I'm glad I did that. So I can say with certainty that giving Jesus a fair hearing is absolutely worth the difficulty and the time, effort, struggle. Absolutely worth it. Just like somebody driving to Yosemite is worth it. Giving Jesus a fair hearing is absolutely worth it. You'll never come away from it saying, oh, gee, what a waste of time. No way. No way will that happen. Guaranteed that will not happen. So this is something we can look at in a very positive light and say, wow, you know, I'm going to get something out of this. I'll get out what I put into it, of course. But if I put a lot into it, I'm going to get a lot out of it. I put a lot into it every day. This morning, I don't know, I'm only a couple out, 2.5 hours in the morning, and here I am then taping in the evening. Maybe I'll put in, you know, five, then maybe work with some graphics or something later on. I mean, I try to put in as much time as possible, maybe, you know, 5 to 8 hours a day, trying to give Jesus a fair hearing, but I used to give a lot more. When I wasn't working, that's what I worked at constantly. And even now I am working, I'm working at that constantly. And you think, well, do you have it? Do you have it yet? Well, I'm still working on it. You see, look at it that way. I'm pretty good at it, I would say. I'm confident enough to at least speak up about it. When Jesus, I was aware he came back in late April, early May, that time period. It's been 6 months now, and I said, I'm back here in the world, and I'm here simply, my only purpose is just to relate with you as friends. That's it. And he said, who wants to do that? And I was looking over this vast multitude. I was part of this vast multitude. He was announcing it to everyone here. And I was looking around, just, you know, waiting. Nobody raised their hand. Uh-oh, that's not a good sign. Oh, gosh. One moment, please. Unbelievable. Someone doesn't want to give Jesus a fair hearing. Sorry. It gave you at least the time to say, okay, we're going to get into this. Nobody wants to give Jesus a fair hearing. As when Jesus said, I'm here as a friend. Stupid. You know, sometimes it's better not to have cell phones at all, you know what I mean? It's just ridiculous interruptions. I try to limit it, but sometimes it happens. Finally, I said, wow, this is terrible. Nobody's taking him up on the offer. This is awful. I couldn't believe it. I said, well, I just can't let this happen. You know, I just can't let it happen. So I'm just going to have to break the ice and say, well, I'll do it. And then Jesus saw me and said, great, let's start. He said, great, all right. You know, and then we had some conversation, you know, friendly conversation. And so I've been doing it. I've been trying for so long to give Jesus a fair hearing. It's something that's part of me. So I'm able to, you know, at least try. I think he has something to say, you know, important to say, really, really, really important to say. And I don't think we've heard what he really has to say. Now, of course, in miracles certainly has helped out. But even that is sort of, in my opinion, the way that it's going, the way that students are going with the course, I mean, everyone's doing the best they can. But to be, it's sort of losing some focus, you know. I still feel we haven't given Jesus a fair hearing, completely fair hearing. What does he really have to say? Well, this morning in my inquiry, it was just, you know, off the charts in term and how to, you know, how to present this is always, you know, interesting. Because nobody's expecting it. You know, people are all nervous. And what is he? Oh, I don't know. What's he going to say? Well, I'll tell you what I believe he has to say. I'm giving my best interpretation of it. First of all, I'd say the most important issue is to reassure us. Okay, first of all, he wants to reassure us. And he has a huge reassurance for us. He's not here to scare us or put on a big show like, look at me, I'm the all-time world's greatest guru, you know. No. He's here to reassure us. He says, okay, forget about the absolute for now. Because that's not our goal for now. Our goal, a wonderful way to say it, is we can, as we're still in this world, so to speak, still dreaming, projecting, dreaming, still perceiving, let's put it that way, we can perceive our pure potentiality for setting the world down, for setting the universe aside, you know, setting the world aside, setting the body, the world, nature, the universe, setting it all aside so that it ultimately is no more. We can perceive and abide in this perceiving our perfect pure potentiality for that. We can see that we're perfectly capable of doing this. And yet, we don't do it. We don't have to do it. We don't do it. This is called the intermediate step. Because we're honoring time, honoring our creativity. So we say, well, no, we're going to, I see I have the potential to make the universe disappear, but I'm not going to do it, not yet. Eventually, this will take place. There'll be a perfect alignment with God and say, okay, you know, I'm ready for it. But no, not yet, and I don't have to. God is not pressuring us to get rid of the universe. Even though, well, now when we talk about the universe, let us be clear what Jesus has to say about the universe. This is what he calls the electromagnetic universe. And this electromagnetic universe is certainly what it is light. We told light, hey, light, create your own absence. Create your own absence. Create the absence of light. And this demand that we put upon light to create its own absence is what we would call this electromagnetic universe. Jesus says the so-called light, what we call light of this universe, is not really light at all. The light that he talks about is not the light of this electromagnetic universe at all. This electromagnetic universe is like a dream. Okay, the true light cannot create its own absence. It's impossible, but it can fake it. And this is why we call this universe is a fake. It's completely fake. It's nothing but pretense. It's fake. There is no real absence of light. But it seems as though there is, right? It's a very clever fake. This, I believe, is what part of what Jesus, you know, has to tell us. This universe is not the Leela or the sport of God at all. Okay? It is Spirit, God the Son, asking light to create its own absence. Create its own absence. Yeah. And then he also says, why are we doing this? Well, it's a silly whim, but it's a whim. It's a way of trying to change reality. We believe we want to change reality so we can say we're more powerful than God. Our will is greater than God's. It's an attempt to be greater than God. Now, another very important aspect of Jesus, what Jesus has to say, which is seems to be rather unique to what he has to say, is that repentance is so important. Okay, so let's look at this. What does he mean by repentance? Very simple. It's simply to admit, hey God, you know, this universe is fake. I've tried to, you know, I'm trying to, you know, trick you. I'm trying to deceive you. I'm trying to be greater than you. I tried to, you know, it's my doing, not yours. It's my doing, not yours. It's my fantasy, not yours. It's my dream. It's my play. It's not yours at all. And I don't really want it anymore. I don't like this experiencing, so I'd like to set it down. This is what's called repentance. It's the opposite of claiming authorship. God saying, God, you did all this. You know, you created death. You created sickness. You created suffering. You created electromagnetic universe. You did. No, we say we did it. We didn't create it. We're imagining it, pretending it, actually. Light, you know, isn't creating its own absence. It's putting on a very weird show for us called the electromagnetic universe. Not that that changes light. Light cannot change what it is, but it appears as though it has as we perceive this universe. So we say, hey God, this is all my doing. And I don't apologize. I just realized it was a silly whim. And I can't be greater than you. I can't change what you are. I can't change reality. So I want to move on from this. And then God will say, wonderful. You're free to keep it if you want, and if you're free to move on from it. So I feel, you know, you still have perfect standing with me either way. So this is quite unique to what Jesus has to say compared to what others have said. And I find it to be very important because that which is, I believe, tried to change and distort Jesus' teaching and has not given a fair hearing, who claims, hey, you know, I know what Jesus says, listen to me, it's the ego, we call it the ego, I call it the ego. It often markets itself as the goddess to seem more attractive and appealing to us. The ego refuses to repent. It says, no. This world is real. It's a real creation. It's not just a silly whim. It's a real creation. And either God did it or... That ego insists that first God has to acknowledge that this is real, and then we'll set it down. But Jesus says, hey, wait a minute. Wait, just a second here. Just for instance, for the sake of looking at this, let's just say hypothetically such a thing could possibly happen, even though it can't. So what the ego is saying is that we're supposed to just get rid of something that's real. get rid of reality, if this universe is real. And the ego says, yeah, first God has to be real, and then we'll get rid of it. I say, wait a minute, I don't want to get rid of reality. I don't want to get rid of something that's real. That's crazy. So right then and there, we should pause and say, whoa, wait a minute. Firstly, make illusions real and then get rid of them. Why would I want to get rid of something that's real? Or something I would cherish that's part of my reality. I wouldn't want to get rid of it. So what the ego really wants to do is wants to hold on to this universe forever. If we made it real, we wouldn't get rid of it. So the ego, what it tells us is, let's make this real. Let's make it real. Whatever that's supposed to mean. Whereas Jesus says, no, repent. Recognize, hey, say to God, this universe isn't real at all. It's just fake. It's completely fake. And I acknowledge that I'm the author of this fakery. And I'm ready to set it down. This is what Jesus is telling us. So, I don't believe that the world has given Jesus fair hearing on this whole repentance issue at all. In fact, I don't think the world's given Jesus a fair hearing about anything. They basically turn to the ego and says, "Hey, ego, what does Jesus have to say?" And the ego says, "Well, I'll tell you," and then it produces its own spiel, tries to put lipstick on it, and pass it off as truth. So we do not have to get rid of this universe. We can say, hey, it's a really creative fake, and yet it is a fake, and I'm the author of this fake, and I'm going to use it to see the pure potential for me to set it down, but I'm not going to set it down yet. This is what Jesus tells us we need to do. Now, what's wrong with that? I don't see anything wrong with it. Seems very fair, very equitable, very wise. Now, we do this by saying what I say is going vertical, to go vertical rather than horizontal. Horizontal is to believe, let's make this world real, time, space, process, and form. The ego tells us, well, it's real, but you just haven't adapted to it yet. You're petulant, you're not learning. You got to learn how to adapt to it. And once you learn how to adapt, then you'll be happy, realize, oh yeah, this is reality. This is true. This is, I'm happy here. And the ego tells us that. So it keeps says, you got to learn. Jesus says, really, the purpose we should be undertaking here is unlearning the lessons that the ego has tried to teach us. And of course, the ego is just the voice of continuity fear, really. The dance of continuity fear, or advising ourselves. Our fear is advising us. When fear is in control, it advises us, do this. It's really just our own fear that's advising us. And we're afraid that the universe will just disappear. We'll say, oh my gosh, it's a fake. Okay, we'll just have to throw it away. No, we don't. We're free to entertain a fakery if we want to. God gave us perfect freedom. That includes entertaining fakery if we want to. So God is not saying we have to throw away the universe. Not at all. And Jesus makes this very clear. God is not telling us what we should experience or have to experience. Not at all. So the wisdom is to see the pure potentiality to set it down. When you go vertical, what it means is you realize that time, space, process, and form don't really have any hold on anything that we're experiencing. So that means at any moment we could have the entire universe disappear for us. Instantly, the whole thing instantly. We have this perfect potential to make the entire universe disappear instantly. But we decide not to for now. And yet we still recognize at all times we do have that potential. We're aware of it. Going vertical is something that gradually will dawn upon you. What this refers to. There is nothing that is not just a simple decision away from revealing the true light that it is. There's nothing at all. And there's nothing that has to happen other than our decision for this revealing to take place. Nothing whatsoever. and you can decide, well, you want to see this that way or this that way. There's nothing stopping our perception from perceiving it that way at all. There's nothing inherent in what we call the universe, what we think is nature, from interfering. And nature does not, it cannot interfere with our decision to perceive differently and ultimately to have it all vanish. It is only just an appearance, a play of light is all it is. Light trying to, pretending to create its own absence. Now Jesus also, I believe this morning I was digging into truth and I saw a perspective that was really quite extraordinary. It flipped the script so severely. I was just like, really, wow. People, it's tough to flip the script because it brings about this wow reaction. You have to be patient with it, right? That's why it's an everyday thing. The path is an everyday. You will flip the script so severely every day that you have to recover from this. We think that parents make the child. It's just the opposite. The child makes the parents. The child makes the parents. This is how it started. This universe and then bodies, for instance, didn't start with the parents. It started with the child. The desire to be a problem. The desire to solve a problem starts with the child. And then the child makes the parents, so to speak, which is the chicken and the egg sort of thing. Well, it's the child, actually. The idea of vulnerability then produces someone who's going to solve the problem of vulnerability. So, in an amazing turnabout, I've never heard anybody talking about this, but it's really the children that make the parents, who bring the parents, so to speak, into, of course, they were children at one point two, but the push is coming from the infant, the idea of this infancy, this child, pushing the whole thing. That's what's pushing. It's not the parents that are pushing it at all, really. And see, I've never had the slightest desire for children. It's never even entered my mind. But most people feel like, you know, they're impelled, you know, to do this, they have to keep doing this, because it's just it's producing this idea of solving problems, solving a problem, taking care of some problem, some burden. Anyway, it's pretty difficult to explain this because it's so different than what we expect. But I saw it very clearly. People think the mother wants to take care of the child. No, it's the child that wants the mother to take care of the child, actually. That's why it is a child. We don't have to go through these cycles of birth, of childhood and adulthood at all. It's totally for the sake of this idea of solving problems, which is a very clever, what came first, the problem or the solution? Well, the desire, what came first is the desire to solve problems, which is really directly saying that reality has a problem. And we're symbolizing that as a child. The child has a problem surviving, so then it needs parents. You see how that works? We don't have to be children, absolutely not. We don't have to have parents, absolutely not. We don't have to be born at all, absolutely not. All this is absurd, actually. So really what's going on is opposite of how we're used to looking at it. So I would say, I wouldn't be surprised if this is something that Jesus would bring to our attention, but we're just so, we think we know what's going on that we don't even question so much. You know, we don't question some fundamental aspects of what's taking place here. And that's one of the most biggest ones, isn't it? You know, giving birth, children, all this kind of stuff. It's really the child that gives birth to itself from a standpoint of the origins of the whole thing. It's a symbol of vulnerability, of littleness, of neediness, of problemness. It's saying, I have a problem. Well, God did not create problems. It's impossible for spirit to have problems. So this is spirit trying to assert that it has changed reality. And the child says, I got problems, I want someone to take care of those problems. And so this is why parents were brought onto the scene. I mean, children can just appear. I mean, if you want to appear as an infant, you can just appear as an infant. You don't need parents. Okay? But of course, if you just appeared as an infant, you'd realize you could also just appear as anything else or not appear as anything else, so you wouldn't be vulnerable at all. So we dreamed of this notion of parents. Absolutely, we did. It has got nothing to do with God whatsoever. So again, I believe this is something that Jesus would tell us. And who would give that a fair hearing? You know, I did this morning, and it was quite something. That was, you know, just wow. This is really quite a turnaround, a different way of looking at that, at it. And don't worry if you're struggling with this. I mean, sure, of course. You know, like, well, what are you saying exactly? Don't struggle. Just take whatever wow you can get out of it. And just we're just trying to give Jesus a fair hearing. And you know, that's what friends, you know, that's a good way to be friends with Jesus. At least be willing to, you know what he's about. Instead of trying to dictate to Jesus, so Jesus, you know, the ego told us what you're all about, so you need to fit into that box. Yeah. And Jesus says, you can't fit me into that box. Christianity, you know, is, well, I've gone over and over and over that, you know, and detailed it. The ego coming in and insisting that it knew what Jesus had to say, and you know, making illusions true, and that getting rid of them, and all the stuff that the ego is involved in, projected upon Jesus, and we still don't have a very good idea. Most have a terribly wrong idea of what Jesus has to say. Have not given a fair hearing at all. Some are struggling to do so. The students of A Course in Miracles are trying to do so. Some are, you know, doing better than others, or some have been doing longer than others too. I mean, there's various factors involved. Some are just, you know, dilettantes. Some are very, very intent. You have all, you know, the whole cornucopia spectrum. The whole thing is there. But here we keep trying. We keep trying to do better every day. You know, establish a new norm every day that we're comfortable with. So okay, the next day, okay, Jesus, you know, let's see if you can make it even more clear to us. Well, what are you really saying? Now, a note about non-duality, not two-ness, means we have one self, not two. But the self that we have is best described as no self. It's still a self, but who said a self has to be defined? Is some definable quality? Who says the self is has boundaries to it? However, that's too absolute, isn't it? The idea that we need to experience no self is what I would say the absolute, and that's not our goal. That's not our goal. So you don't hear Jesus talking about what you might say is like pure non-duality, you know, I am the no-self, there's, you know, I am the absolute. He doesn't really talk quite like that. It's not his goal, isn't it? And he says that's not our goal, really. Now, what I've experienced is interesting, that the qualities of the self has qualities. Bliss, gratitude, love, peace, freedom. It radiates in all directions. Well, it's just, well, for the sake of what our goal is, which is to see our pure perfect potential to you know, set the universe down, really, to have it disappear, our pure potential for that. But we're not doing that. Well, the way that our self appears to us perceptually then would be sort of like it. I experienced it as if it were like some sort of disc, like a round ball, and this was radiating in 360 degrees, you know, the whole ball in entirely, it was radiating all directions, like the sun, you might say, radiating in all directions, these qualities. So it seemed as though these qualities were emanating from this, you know, center, as it were. But, of course, that's just a perception. The real self is absolute and just is all those qualities. It's not radiating from anywhere. It just that's what it is. But this is, again, we're not trying to reach this realization. And nor should we. Because Jesus says, such a realization, you couldn't remain here for very long at all. It might be possible, he said. So, you know, Jesus is very honest with us, I would say. Very, very honest and straightforward with us. So it seems as though, in perceptually again, that there's this center that was radiating these qualities, and we would call that the self. You know, this is by true identity the self. But it's really a perception of the self, which is fine, because Jesus says that that's all we need. That once we get used to this perception of the self, perceiving our perfect capability, potentiality, to set, you know, say, okay, universe, that's enough. That whole, the entire electromagnetic universe saying, okay, bye-bye. I see that you're nothing but light, and the deception's over, you know, the pretense is over. That's what we want to see. It's all a pretense, and we can have the pretense end anytime we want to, but we're choosing not to, and so we're keeping perception, and so it seems as though the self has some sort of locus, you know. But within that center, there's no particular quality. The center itself doesn't have any particular qualities. It's what is emanating, what seems to be emanating from it, that are the qualities. So we would talk of a self as if it were somewhere. Okay, I see the self. The self seems to be here. There's nothing wrong with that. There's nothing wrong with that. See, we're not trying to be absolutist about this whole thing. We're being what's called pragmatists. Now, what Jesus says is the Holy Spirit is a creation of by God, the Father, the prime creator, to help us, free us, help us go vertical, ultimately out of this pretense of time, space, process, and form, which is, of course, light pretending to have created its own absence. So helping us ultimately set down this electromagnetic universe and realize it was just light, it was a pretense, but more importantly, to take this intermediate step of perceiving our perfect potentiality to do this. So the Holy Spirit, that Jesus says, is very pragmatic, perfectly pragmatic, as is Jesus. So I would say Jesus is very much a pragmatist. He does not insist on this absolutist position. Now, throughout history, you know, the people have wrangled about this, philosophers. Well, is this qualified non-dualism or this and this and that? You know, well, we don't get caught up in those sort of, you know, that type of dialogue and stuff. Because Jesus is very direct and tells us, no, this is an intermediate step. So it's just, you know, is it dualism or non-dualism? It's an intermediate step to the absolute. So you might say it's the essential step to pure non-dualism. All right, but you can't reach pure non-dualism here. This is what Jesus, I believe, this is what Jesus tells us. Now, you say, well, what about Rama Maharshi? Well, he might be, you know, he's like a perfect example of this, you know, flawless intermediate step, where he was still functional here, still aware of a body, but for him it was just like nothing. It was like just a shadow, just like that center of the self. You see, there's like as if there's a center where everything is emanating from, but the center itself doesn't have any qualities at all. This would be, in my opinion, what Ramana Maharshi was experiencing and explaining to us. He says, like, the world's just like nothing. I mean, I still see it, but it's just like an empty shadow. Yeah, there's no real qualities to the world itself at all. So was he abiding in the absolute, Well, or a flawless mirror, of the absolute. I would say flawless mirror. Jesus says you cannot remain in this world if you're truly true abidance in the absolute. There's not even any abidance. It's so far beyond, any conceptuality or any way of that you cannot. You said you couldn't remain here. Your body would just vanish. Really. So again, this is what I believe Jesus has to say. Very wise, very pragmatic, very honest, very helpful. Now, let's say our view of the universe, we're seeing it in the, you could say, qualified non-dual way, or the intermediate step way, or the perfect potentiality way. Perfect potentiality way. Let's say I injured my foot yesterday, and it was just hurting so bad. I said, oh boy, this is trouble. Well, apparently the purpose of getting the injury and everything served its purpose. And today, there's no problem at all. Can't feel anything, everything's fine. I mean, it's quite extraordinary. My toe looks terrible, just bruised and purple and red. Oh gosh, it looks awful. But there's no pain whatsoever. Now, from a standpoint of viewing our pure potentiality to make the universe to have the universe just disappear, we're free to, we could view like an injury like that. We can view it and say, okay, I don't need it anymore. I don't need to see that anymore. I don't need to experience it anymore. I can see, I'd rather just see it witness to the pure potentiality to set it down instantly. And so I'll see it that way, that it doesn't have any qualities of itself, of its own whatsoever. And so we could be get well instantly. Absolutely, instantly. Or we could say, I'd like to just see that sort of witness to holding on to the universe for a while, and so I'll have that illness or something seem to have duration, give it the illusion of duration, but still seeing I could choose not to if I wanted to also. I could choose no duration to it whatsoever. But still seeing the potential for injury or sickness, the body's still there. I'll still see the potential. I just won't utilize that potential, to be sick. I'll see it, I'll have it like just on the brink of vanishing. So I just have it like there's no duration of any trouble whatsoever, kind of thing, like that. Very much, as if it was radiating all these, emanating all these, everything's emanating all these qualities. And pain and suffering is not one of them. So, I don't know where the trouble went, but it's in my foot. But it certainly isn't there today. I actually went running and jogging today. I was having a very hard time even walking yesterday. And today, there's no effects of it whatsoever. I find that very interesting. Ramana Maharshi, his body got some sort of cancer, and it eventually body succumbed to that. And same with Ananda Mai Ma. She eventually, I don't know, she didn't get any sickness. She just eventually, her breath stopped eventually. But everyone said, hey, we know you could cure yourself of this illness instantly. We know you've done it. We've seen you do it. We know you can do it. It's not any trial for you. And she said, yeah, well, that's true. I could, but she says, the unmanifest seems to be just a way of talking. It seemed to be, I seem to be journeying in that direction now. And says the same to me. It's no difference at all for me. It just happens the body won't be manifest here for a while, whatever. But could she have stepped in? Absolutely. Just chose to have the body appear to be well or young or whatever. Makes no difference as long as there's an appearance, perceiving and appearancing, it can be whatever we want it to be, really. It's just a way of keeping the pure potentiality of us setting down the universe without actually setting it down. But we can be quite fluid in how we have the universe appear. We don't have to appear to be sick and aging and all this stuff. No, not really. Not really. Jesus resurrected the body. He said, hey, you know, I choose to have the body appear again, and this is how it appears. You see, he says, piece of cake. Not any trouble at all for me. Or for us. You know, once we repent. He made it very clear that you will do all these miracles and more. You know, so it would be easy, just no trouble at all. You can move mountains, literally. Literally. Realizing the verticality of all appearancing. Which nothing is bound by any time, space, or process form. No appearance is bound at all. Never has been. We don't have to free appearance from anything. Keep in mind, it's light pretending to have created its own absence, but it hasn't. Light is not absent. So we can tell the light to move the mountain. It has an appearance, and it moves. But this world is a collective imagination, exercising collective imagination, so it doesn't seem to happen that way. But there certainly is, we certainly can have a lot of fluidity in once we see the pure potential to set it all down. We certainly can have a lot of fluidity. I don't know how much. But historically, we've seen spiritual situations in the world, with, you know, a lot of examples of showing there's a great deal of fluidity, actually. And Jesus says this. He says, actually, your body doesn't have to get old at all or impaired or anything. Not at all. If you don't want it to, it won't. As long as we've repented, law is not trying to make time, space, process, form real. The way we're trying to make it real is through death and aging and change and all this stuff. So, all this stuff is, if we want to believe that time, space, process, and form, its horizontalness is real, then this is what we've dreamed up. You know, so we will feel almost like we feel it's just like a natural cycle. You know, this is just nature. You know, no, nature doesn't exist. We've dreamed up this way of trying to generate false evidence that time, space, process, and form are becoming real or are real. We just made all this up. Again, this is what I believe Jesus has to say. We've just simply made all this up. Be saying, well, yeah, what do we do? What do we do? Well, Jesus again is very reassuring. Don't worry. He said, just you know, hear and don't have to do anything. Don't have to make the universe disappear. That's not the goal. Could we make it disappear? Yes. Should we? Probably not. Probably not. Because of the continuity fear. Will we make it disappear? Most likely not. Even though we could see, once we see we could make it disappear, very likely, almost certainly, we will not have it make it disappear. We will not choose to have it disappear. We will not do that. And then Jesus is very honest with us, tells us it would be an extremely rare exception for anyone to decide, once they see that they can make it disappear, to make it disappear. This is just, you know, incredibly rare for it. Theoretically, it could happen, but it's not going to happen. For all intents and purposes, we will not have the universe disappear. Choose to have it disappear for us. No. So that eases things up a lot, doesn't it? Say, okay, well, I can see the verticality of everything, meaning no appearance is bound by time, space, process, form, and all the universe is merely an appearance. That's all it is. There's no real No such thing as nature, actually, at all. No such thing as nature. It doesn't really exist at all. Meaning, horizontally, time, space, process, and form. It's like a dream. It's not real. We can stop a dream anytime we want to, right? Once you, like, have lucid dreaming, do you stop dreaming? No, you might keep on dreaming, right? You say, okay, I'm aware I'm dreaming. Do I have to stop dreaming? No, you might say, well, let me dream, you know, let me keep dreaming, but stay perfectly aware that it is just a dream and really has no effect on the dreamer at all. None. Now is this non-dual, dual order? No, it's just Jesus. You know, it's just Jesus telling us, I believe, being a friend. It's just Jesus being a friend to us and explaining and reassuring to us. It doesn't have to be labeled necessarily, you know. Jesus, in my opinion, how I take it is, he has a, you know, big context. He adds on a lot of context to the whole situation, and it helps us that way, which is, I find that very helpful. When stuff gets stuffed into a system or something, there's a tendency for it to lose context, and throughout history, as the ego works on it, it tends to become more and less and less reassuring as we sort of lose the big overall context, and then it becomes more and more difficult because they say, why? That sounds kind of scary, you know. So Jesus is very much about the big context, the big picture, and helping us see that. Now, Jesus did point out, when he came here a couple thousand years ago, he said the apostles really didn't understand him very well. No, he said nobody really understands me very well. The one who does it best is Peter, but he still doesn't understand me well. In fact, he renounced me 3 times, you know. But you know, at least this is what it says, that at least he had a slightly better comprehension than the others, which was not very much to speak of. Some, okay, and same with Paul, so they had some. But he said, you know, you're going to have to get better, and when I come back, you'll be a lot better off, he says. You'll have a lot better understanding of what I really have to say. So he's back, and we do have a better understanding of what he has to say. But it hasn't just been a matter of luck. You know, I didn't just wake up one morning and say, oh, I feel lucky today. I guess I'm going to understand Jesus today. Unless luck has had nothing to do with it, it's 100%. Work. Inspiration, which is the product of intense work, intense dedication, putting myself in a position to handle the success, you know, and then working on handling the success. So I just made it my business to do this, that's all. And anyone can do this. Nobody is stopping anyone from deciding this is what I want my business and my life business to be. Give Jesus a fair hearing. Find out what he really has to say. It's very interesting. I find it actually the most interesting of any teacher I've ever come across. Jesus is the most interesting, what he has to say. It's just really, it seems to, you know, hit so many great notes and chords, and just wow. And there are others that are also very, very interesting. Absolutely. But it seems as though Jesus is, you know, making a huge effort, outreach effort, and this is, you know, that counts. That counts for a lot. And it happens to be right now. And so, you know, let's get with it here. It's what's happening. So get with it. Now I'm getting reports from people from all over how it is around the world. They're expressing grievances. I get a lot of people talking with me expressing grievances, very severe grievances about the world. Well, God, Jesus has very good news. This is not your home. It's not your home at all. It's nobody's home. It's not a home at all, actually. And the effort to make time real, you know, time, space, process, and form, to make the absence, the apparent absence of light real, it is brutal. And it's terrible. And absolutely, yeah, Jesus, well, as far as grievances go, Jesus says, well, you know, drop all your grievances because you're only asking, you should just forgive yourself because you're the one who asked for this suffering. That is true. However, that doesn't mean, though, that we're going to love the world the way that it is, you know, as far as believing that it's real. We say, oh yeah, all this stuff, terrible stuff's real, but I'm supposed to like it. No, that is not what Jesus is saying at all. Not at all. He's saying all this fear-based projection and confusion and attack and all this stuff is at the level of personality, and at that level, it's horrible. It's terrible. But we don't have to see ourselves as a personality. We don't have to see the universe as real. We don't have to see all this as somehow we're something, form, stuck in this, you know, haunted house, you know. We can change our perception and see, I can set this entire universe down this instant if I wanted to, if I chose to. And I don't have any form, but I can see myself as just this, a center with no qualities, and then emanating from that center is just all these, you know, perfect qualities. And so Jesus has a lot to say about that, but we don't want to struggle too much with it. But grievances is something that I find that people are struggling with very severely. So the way I see it is go at it in a sort of a roundabout way of developing a context for the situation, what we think is the situation here. Developing a context, and most important is that there's this intermediate step. See, we do not have to attain to perfection. We already are perfect. Light is perfect. We just asked light to pretend that it didn't exist, create its own absence. So there seems to be a process of making that happen, which seems terrible. Right? And this is all necessary to make it seem as if it is happening. And so if we want to believe that light is creating its own absence, or has, and somehow is sustaining it, or is improving it somehow, is an overall process here, we could call it, then we can certainly experience all these so-called grievances and troubles, and they can be very terrible. So we're not saying that the experiencing isn't very terrible. Absolutely it is. What I believe Jesus is saying is that we have a choice in the matter, though. We can look at it a different way. And at which case we say, oh, we don't need this. You know, we're not worshiping time, we're honoring it. And we're just honoring it by seeing our pure potential to set down this dream. But don't struggle too much with this. You know, it can be rather aggravating if we push too hard on this. So Jesus is not trying to take our suffering away from us, force it away from us. Just saying, just give a hearing to the overall what he's saying. And he says, if you want to keep suffering, by all means, you can, you know, keep suffering if that's what you want. But we might start seeing the verticality of everything. If everything is vertical, then how can we really suffer at all? like Jesus rose from the dead, raised others from the dead. That's just going vertical. He's seeing, we can perceive everything as vertically. He said, just get up, Lazarus, right now. He said, well, he's been in there for 3 days or 4 days. He says, well, it doesn't matter. It's just an appearance. Restore yourself to your previous appearance, just like that, vertical. No horizontal. Jesus saw no horizontal, nothing horizontal at all. Now, you can also see that the potential, as long as you're perceiving, you can be aware of the potential to imagine it's horizontal, you know, to pretend it is, so that there's that potential too, to pretend there is. But you're seeing it as really it's all vertical. No matter how much you pretend it's horizontal, it's still all vertical, actually. It's what it actually is in terms of the light. The light's always vertical, you know. I mean, it's just 100% vertical, meaning it can be anything you want it to be any instant. There's no horizontal bondage to process at all. Now, for me, all this makes sense. It sounds very reasonable. I don't struggle with it. I just say, yeah, this sounds very reasonable. But also don't try to take it too far, you know, into too much struggle. If you feel it's too much struggle, you know, just ease into it. Be careful not to get into too much struggle. When you feel that, just to take a stop, take a break, a full stop in the wow. And just kind of let the wow marinate in the wow. So this I would suggest seeing the self as if it did have a center to it. And you would see the center as having no discernible qualities, except you would just say, well, it seems like sort of this, just this round ball that really is just nondescript. I can't really give it, you know, any description to it. It just seems this spatial area from which it seems as though all these qualities are emanating, because they seem to radiate out from that. And I would suggest just being happy with that. Be accepting of that. Say, this is good enough. I at least this is what, now this is just me, this is not Jesus, you know, me trying to understand what Jesus had to say, but I sort of feel that one of the ways something that can arise is those who trying to push the absolute on us, which creates this fear-based dependency sort of situation, as seeing them as this center, because they want to have some perception of a center. They then become the center, and then these problems arise with some of these gurus, etc., that they're not really emphasizing this intermediate step that keeps us in control and in feeling okay and not so fearful and all that. It's easy to say, well, you're still perceiving a center to it, and you say, well, you need to be going to the absolute, and you just, you know, you're not there yet, but, you know, I can help you with it. It seems as though this ends up as exploitive. I don't feel Jesus is exploitive. I really don't. I've never experienced him that way in the slightest bit. I don't feel it's there at all. And I feel he's just pragmatic. And is not trying to rush us and not trying to prove anything, like, hey, I'm the greatest guru there's ever been, and, you know, I'm the absolute, you know, pure absolute, and you poor people here just don't know how to realize that, but if you really focus on me, you know, you will realize your absolute freedom and stuff like this. No, Jesus is not that way. He's not that way. He certainly brings up the overall context, but stresses this intermediate step. He stresses the intermediate step because of this Because of continuity fear, absolutely. So, the big shot gurus who are trying to push this absolute and have these following of sycophants, kind of their dependence, you know, codependency there, they tend to say that Jesus is not such a big deal. They say, well, yeah, Jesus, but he's a, you know, he was pretty far along, but not nearly far along as, you know, this great guru. Not my realization. No, I'm way beyond that. Yeah, but Jesus, he was, you know, he was kind of still struggling and caught in this sort of qualified dualism, you know, not qualified non-dualism, and he still had, you know, he needs some help. They tend to look down on Jesus, actually. They tend to look down on Jesus, and so make you feel, if you're looking at Jesus, they say, well, you're kind of, really, you could do a lot better than that. You know, you could be listening to them. So, this just causes problems. It causes me some problems, struggle, you know, difficulty. But I would disagree. I would just say, well, you know, that's how you see it. I find that Jesus is, you know, hits the right notes, and I feel he's being very pragmatic and very helpful. Therefore, very helpful. And I can see the wisdom and reasoning behind what he's saying, and I don't feel that that makes him some sort of lesser teacher. I just don't see that, you know, that Jesus is some lesser teacher to these other teachers who are teaching, you know, absolute, total, perfect freedom, non-dualism. You right now, you can realize it, just come see me and put all your attention on me and also, you know, everything else. Surrender your life to me, you know. No, it doesn't make him a lesser teacher. I just don't see that at all. I think Jesus is knows what's effective, what's helpful, what's effective, and is helping us. And therefore, it doesn't make us lesser, you know, realizers. I mean, you know, I can realize my perfect potential to set the universe down, make it disappear, and I say, I'm good with that, and just say, okay, this is my new norm. You know, and then someone else might say, well, you know, yeah, you just kind of had this sort of middle kind of realization. It's not really the high. And then I say, well, what are you doing? Well, I'm this, you know, devotee of this great guru who's, the true absolute God in the world, you know, true absolute. And yeah, I mean, I don't have it yet because I'm told I'll never really get it because I can't be as great as this teacher, you know. But at least I'm way better than you because at least I'm focusing on the absolute and you're not, you know. And what I would just say to them, look, familiarity is decisive. So I'm getting familiar with the qualities of reality at this, but maintaining my perception, you see. And at some point, I will be very familiar with all those, and then I'll be ready for the absolute. So, you know, this is pragmatic. It is what works. And they're overlooking the continuity problem and familiarity. They're trying to take a leap, you know, a leap into the absolute. And the great guru says, I need to leap into the absolute, you know, so that's what I'm working on. So eventually I'll be able to do that, and I'll, you know, no. eventually you'll realize that you decided not to do that. So it's okay to see the self, okay? It's okay to see the self. See your situation. If you want to see yourself as the self, just as this is the, it's like we're like in a, we can still feel like we are present as a self, as just this area, kind of like a round area, as it were. And then we're aware of all these qualities that seem to be, you know, part of what we are. That's fine to experience like that. This is what we should experience. I think of something, I read a title of, some teacher quipped this, you know, like, well, who is aware that there is no self? You know, well, this gets into absolutism, you know. And this is what I Jesus has been trying to help us out of, this whole thing of kind of one-upsmanship, you know. Where And non-dual teachers are sort of guilty of this, you know, one-upsmanship. You could see it that way. You could take it that way if that's what they're actually doing, or they could just be actually helping loosen up the whole knots of the whole construct, you know, or both. Or, you know, I'm not exactly sure what their motivations are. But this one-upsmanship, well, who is aware that there is no self? You know, come on. We don't need that. That's just a, you know, sort of an obstructionist question to pragmatism. And we might say, well, who is it that cares about, you know, cares about my answer and me answering this? Really, if you want to come back on the teacher that says, well, you know, who, they say, what about yourself? Well, I'm no self. They say, okay, well, who's experiencing no self? I said, well, who is it that wants to know? Who is it that's experiencing no self? You know? If you want to play that game, you could, you know, you could play it that way. You know, touche. I mean, say, so, well, I'm the self that I'm experiencing the self, you know, because this is perception. I know perception isn't the absolute. Jesus says it's not. I know it's not. So what? I have a severe continuity fear. That's my problem. So I'm solving my problem. What's wrong with that? And then they say, well, who is it that's solving your problem? Well, ultimately, it's God, the Spirit, that's solving the problem, yes. But and this is how it's doing it, by still perceiving as if there is some locus of the self for now. That's how it's doing, solving this issue of continuity fear issue. So what's the, you know, what's the question? That is the answer. You know, why do you have to answer their question, you know, directly, like, well, who is it that's experiencing no self? I mean, well, why do you have to be locked into this? Why don't you just say, well, this is the context? And so that is the answer. The context is the answer. So Jesus is wonderful at helping us see this bigger context, and so we don't feel, you know, troubled by spiritual gamesmanship. Now, is it really gamesmanship or not? I mean, that depends on maybe each one of us, how we look at it. You know, what we put into it, we might get out of it. But it potentially, sure, there could be spiritual gamesmanship taking place. It's happened, I would say. Maybe it's happened. And so we can just feel comfortable about just saying, well, yeah, you know, who is it that wants to know? Who is it that is experiencing that there's no self? Who is it that's asking this? Who, you know, who wants to know? Who is it that's asking this question? You say, well, I'm the teacher. I've got to ask these questions. Well, who is it that want, you know, that wants to ask, needs to ask these questions? And they say, well, you want to. Well, who am I then? How do you know that I want you to ask these questions? So, you know, well, this is not the way it's supposed to go. And that's okay, you know, because the answer for me is a context. What would Jesus have to say, you know? What would Jesus have to say about this? Well, it is a context here. Continuity, fear, context, I would say, is what's important, not who is it that's experiencing no self. You guys, right now, I would say perception is. I say, well, what is perception? Well, it's something that we've imagined for the purpose of, you know, trying to create its own absence, and I'm holding on to it because I'm not ready for the absolute yet. I want to get familiar with the qualities of reality before I realize that there isn't any, that it's omnipresent, you know, and so there's nothing wrong with that at all. That's what we're supposed to do. And they're saying, well, we're trying to help you get beyond that. No. Abidance in this perception of the self, of our perfect potentiality, and the qualities emanating from this quality-free self, that is getting the job done right there. That familiarity is what is decisive. So we don't have to be helped beyond that. Jesus says very clearly, God takes the final step for us. There's no guru that helps us with that. God is the one that takes the final step into the absolute. Absolute realization is it comes from actual God the Father. It does not come from teachers. Okay, this is a very important point that Jesus has pointed out. I don't believe people realize this so much. The final step, which is the realization of simply the pure absolute, is a step that God takes for us. We don't take it. Guru doesn't take it for us, etc. They say, well, Guru is God. Not really. Not really. Okay, God the Son, and not God the Father. And so abidance in this is all we need to do. There's nobody that is going to take us further. You know, some of these gurus, they play this game of however far you go, say, well, yeah, but I'm here to take you further. No. Once you're in abidance, perceiving the self and the qualities of the self, experiencing the qualities of the self, that's it. Just get used to it. You don't need to go further. Just the very fact you're getting used to it is what ultimately then enables the final step, for God to take the final step. That's it. So again, I believe this is what, you know, Jesus would say. This is giving a fair hearing. I believe this is what we would need to hear. So Jesus is not here to help us take the final step. No. He's here to help us take the intermediate step. But he says he doesn't help to take the last step. God takes the last step for us. Not Jesus. Not God the Son. No. Talk about humility. It's that right there. So when Jesus said, well, people say, well, Jesus, he's not really that great of a teacher. He's okay, but he's not really that high. He's kind of high, but not the highest. Well, wait a minute. You know, Jesus is very humble. So he says, hey, I'm not the one that takes the last step for you. Not at all. That's God the Father's province right there, not mine. That's called being honest and truthful. And not laying some big guru trip on us. He said, again, I come back not to lay some big guru trip on you, but just to hang out as your friend. That's it. Just to relate as friends. We're all looking for some big guru to show up. You know, maybe I don't think Jesus is that big like that. In fact, what I saw this morning was that Jesus first comes back as an adult, like a, you know, full adult, 30-something or whatever. But I think that's just to start off with. I think later Jesus may appear as a child, which is a lot closer to verticality, so to speak. And even more helpful for us. Of saying the child comes first. If the child, the idea of the child has originated all of this, the baby has originated all of this, actually. And also the child is not so identified, you know, with the whole thing. See, a youth, you know, a very young youth, he might appear very youthful, like 11, 10 years old, 11 or 12 or something, or even less, you know. I don't believe he's going to appear as an infant. Maybe at some point, you know, they have the tradition, Christianity, of the Christ child, Santo Nino, Christ child. That's very profound, actually. And they show the Christ child with all this radiating, you know, light and stuff. Well, this is a way of saying the self, you know, seeing the self as just a small, like an infant, without any qualities of its own, so to speak, but somehow it's radiating. This is a way of symbolizing it. Now, Christianity is not without a lot of powerful, powerful symbols. It's just that the ego's done everything possible to, you know, distort as much as possibly can and replace it with the ego's own teachings. So I'm not saying Jesus has to appear. You appeared as a grown man, and so you must stay that way. Maybe later he will appear as younger. Ananda Maimon, for instance, very strongly asked everyone to see her as a little, their little daughter. Like a preschool or just, you know, elementary school type of age, something like that. She says, please, please don't see me as mother. That's not right. That won't help you very much. It'll actually cause problems for you. See me as a little child. See me as just your child, a daughter, little daughter. And this is how she acted most of the time, as like a child. She acted like a little girl, a child. Most of the time, a lot of the time. And those who wanted to see her as a mother, then she tended to act more as adult. And so, but to those, the more advanced devotees, she would often be like a little child. Exactly like it. You know, they were astonished. They said, how can anybody who seems to be a grown adult behave so flawlessly as a little, wonderful little child, you know? Because she said, well, this is what really, you know, as far as perceptual-wise, this is what I really am. It's like a little child. I'm not identified. She never identified with adulthood at all. Never identified with it. Never identified with the body, really, either. But as far as roles go, never identified as the adult, the parent, you know, the grown-up. It's always like the divine child, you know, with these qualities radiating from her. Bliss, peace, joy, you know, love, perfection, gratitude, grace, all these qualities just radiating. This is possible, you know, in this world for us to experience that. We could even be that way. That's what Jesus says. That's how we're supposed to be. We can absolutely be that way. So Jesus is not necessarily going to always be, you know, this adult. We're used to in the Bible seeing him that way. But he could also appear as very youthful. That's perhaps a better way to view Jesus, actually, as a youth. A young lad, you know, youth, very youthful, and just very quiet and peaceful, and you just feel this wonderful qualities. And the body, of course, the appearance is just a placeholder for us. That's all. It's not creating the qualities at all. We had a lot of rain come through here. A storm from Alaska. Cold. Even possibly some snow on the mountains. Interesting. Different climate pattern here. Thunderstorms. Lots of lightning. Strong thunder. This is rare for us here. And, you know, pretty good soaking. Maybe a half inch, but, you know, it came down. So, you know, hey, it has to start somewhere. There's a lot of moisture in the atmosphere in the world. You know, it's got to fall somewhere. Might as well fall in California. Might as well fall where we need it, right? I think Texas has got enough rain, you know. I think their drought's been pretty well wiped out quickly, you know. It's amazing. So, hey, you know, Texas, send us your rain. Tell the rain to go to California now. You know, I'm glad you got your rain. Absolutely. That's fantastic. Very happy about that. There's been many places are suffering from very bad drought. And right now, I think California is the one that is most in severe trouble, actually. And everybody, you know, pray for California that it gets rain, or seriously. I mean, if, you know, we just have to get it this winter. I don't even want to, I'm not going to even think about it if we don't get it. This shows you how fragile civilization is, right? It's happened before in many civilizations, they didn't get the rain. And that's it. You can't run a civilization without water. I don't know what we'll do. I go get a big tank, plastic tank, and fill it with salt water, and then take showers with that. You'd flush your toilet with salt water. You could do that, sure. You could get a big salt water tank, and you could have trucks delivering salt water. That's they go to the ocean, yeah, pump it in, and they put in some pipeline quickly to distribute salt water. And we could, be flushing the toilet with salt water and taking showers with salt water, and but couldn't water the plants with it and couldn't drink it. I mean, let your plants die and you drink bottled water. So, we could get by that way, I would imagine. Could hose things down with salt water. Yeah, there's plenty of salt water available. There's no question about that. Probably need to start using it, more of it, We could just put the salt water through a, jump station, really, and it would just come out. It would flow through this imaginary, screen or wall. I mean, not, it would just be like a an open area with a frame around it or something, and just flow through there. And as it comes out of this little area, what goes in salt and comes out pure. How does that happen? Well, we just decide that's what we want. That's how it happens, actually. This is how, the idea of the world, we've got to solve problems scientifically and mathematically, is totally egoic way of thinking. Totally. Now we could put a bunch of bells and whistles, like a jump station that they have the to going to Mars or something, and we could build some apparatuses, that so people think, well, this is very scientific, that's why it's working, and that but our intention is that this is what happens, then it would just happen. And you say, well, we can't quite explain it. Somehow the composition of the salts and everything shifts dimensions or something, You'd have you need dimensions to try to explain science, but ultimately you don't even need dimensions at all. So science will get all multidimensional on us and stuff, but that's just all bells and whistles. You don't even need it at all. Jesus turned the water into wine, just straight out, right? To get the water, and he said, okay, now it's wine. Vertical. There is just, the light. And Jesus says, okay, light, I want you to appear as wine. And so the light appeared as wine. Before, the light was appearing, giving appearance as water. Now Jesus says, okay, light, I want you to appear as wine. Done. So we got the seawater. Okay, seawater, we now want you to appear as pure water. Boom, done. Of course, with all the fish, the sea life, marine life, we wouldn't want to do that to them. Although we could also say, now you're perfectly adapted to freshwater, and then done. But if we could pipe it in, this big pipe, this massive pipe, pipeline from the ocean, pumping, millions of gallons a minute or whatever, and it would just emerge, put the sluice way or something, with a pipe around it or something. So, and some LEDs and a bunch of wire, whatever, and people say, oh, something's happening, and it just come out as pure water. It's no problem at all. Grow all the crops you want to grow. You can just have the water appear. We're not quite ready for that. We say, oh, that's scary, just light appear as water. There it is. We could also just have the plants appear directly, actually, without using any water at all. But we kind of like using water and soil. We could just have fruit appear, food appear if we wanted. But we said, no, I want to see a process. So, okay, all right, fine, that too. But there's no point in any of this wanting to see a process where it actually is a process. So we can intervene at any point and just say, okay, we'll just skip that part of it. It don't have water. Don't need water. We don't need water to grow any of that stuff. Come on. This is just ABCs, you know. This is not. This is just spirit in its, rudimentary way. I mean, even here with perception, we can function this way. We pretty much often choose not to. But even in the, other realms, so-called, with astral realm, we do function this way. But we also keep a little bit of, let us go out and tend our garden a little bit if we want to. If it's fun to believe that we need to pour water on a tree, why not pour? What's wrong with pouring water on the tree? If that's a little game we want to play, it's amusing for us, then why not? As long as they don't take it too seriously. And, the tree, always growing fruit. Okay, and then we said, I want some fruit right now. Oh, look at that. One of the fruit just fell. It's perfectly ripe. Oh, how about that? It's not in season. Well, I just changed the season. It's winter. Well, I want it to be spring. I said, well, I want the fruit now. Oh, it's summer then. Oh, it's summer. Wonderful. And so we can play with the seasons, And that's fine. This is what happens in the astral realm, causal realm, this is what we do there. But we tend to say, well, we can't do it here, because we're trying to play hardcore time-space process and form here. But we could do it here. It's like, well, people say, well, it's not the astral realm. Well, the astral realm isn't the astral realm. That's just a name for what we're, a funk of pretending, a style of pretending. So is the causal realm, still a style of pretending, this realm. So all the realms are just one pretense, different styles of it. Some, causal realm have kind of eased off a lot of it. You say, well, I don't really need to eat. don't have any appetite, no need to eat. I just let light flow through me or something. Just enjoy. All the qualities of spirit. But those are all nice perceptual games we can play. But, science and technology is just the bottom of the barrel. It's the bottom of the barrel. they like to call it magic, They say all science is really magic. No. It's all pretense. It's not like the people that, who are playing less and less games are like these great scientists and understand how the electromagnetic universe works and know how to manipulate it. No, not at all. They say, what do you need that for? It's ridiculous. If I want a fruit, this fruit just appears. I just tell the light, I want to see a fruit. If I want to eat it, I'll tell light, hey, make me feel hungry, and then make me eat the fruit. I want to eat the fruit, and make me the appearance of eating the fruit. And there's no magic to that. There's no science to it. There's no mathematics to it. This world is the bottom of the barrel here. We're scraping the bottom of the barrel right now. We're all so busy. Everyone's frantic because they're all scraping the bottom of the barrel. They say, oh, I got to keep doing it. It's not getting very much. I got to keep scraping and scrape, 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 scrape. Everybody's spent all their time scraping the bottom of the barrel. What is that? We don't have to scrape the bottom of the barrel. So again, let us give Jesus a fair hearing here, and hear this perspective. Hear this perspective, and I'm trying to do my best, understanding and explanation of what I hear coming from Jesus. What I feel is what he has to impart to us. And there's more. You can look in all different directions, but I feel all this is quite important. Wow, we'll have to get used to this cold weather. I guess this whole week is going to be, the next 10 days, cold. Low 60s. Today, I think it was upper 50s, low 60s. We just came off of, you know, high 80s for the last 4 years. And it's like, what is this? We just shifted into this. I think it's snowing in the Sierras right now. 3 to 5 inches in various, you know, maybe more in other places. Great. Bring on the snow. That's what really helps us, is the snowpack. Could it snow in the tropics? Sure, if we wanted the snow, it would snow. If we asked it to, really, let it snow. Doesn't even have to be cold to snow, actually. If we wanted snowflakes to fall, they would fall. That is true. The idea that everything has these properties is not true. It has the appearance of property, sure, but it's just an appearance. Can you change dirt into diamonds? Of course. No, well, actually, no. But can you have the appearance we call dirt morph into the appearance we call diamonds? Of course. You can have it morph into anything. The idea that we need to be some sort of spiritual master and master the electromagnetic, you know, the electrons and the atoms and this is ridiculous. This is completely backwards. You just tell the light what kind of appearance you want and it's done. You want appearance of dirt? It's done. You want appearance of diamond? It's done. It's all the same to light. It's all just light. There's no real difference at all, is there? None whatsoever. 100% pure appearance of light. Light doesn't have some difficulty with diamonds. Well, dirt's easy, but diamonds, that's real tough, you know. No. All appearances are equally easy for light. Even the appearance of the absence of light. It's like that Togo's commercial of the guy holding the, I think it's, is it Togo's? I think it's a, yeah. Yeah, that's so heavy I can hardly lift it, you know. Oh, man. You know, here, let me help you. It's like, oh, he's pretending like something's really heavy when it's really not, you know. But we can pretend, you know. Oh, it's so difficult for the light, you know, to do this. Oh, my gosh, the light. But it's really not difficult. We just have fun pretending. We like to pretend. You know, like kids, they like to pretend, don't they? They do a lot of pretending because this is what this situation's all about, is pretense. And I'm pretending, you know, that I'm, you know, I'm heavy. I can't move. I'm so heavy. Now I'm pretending I'm really light. Oh, I feel so light. I'm light. But is the light having difficulty? So I can't move. You know, is the light really? The light can't move? I mean, is the light stuck? Is the light ever stuck? You know, it's not stuck. The light's not stuck. Pretending that it's stuck doesn't mean it's stuck. Yeah, and you know who? What is it that knows that the light isn't stuck? You know. What is it that needs to know? What is it that knows that light isn't stuck? You know, what is it? Something need to know? What is it that knows that light isn't stuck? Come on. Those are just mind games. They can be, you know, if they have some purpose, if it helps someone out, that's fine. Well. Nothing's stuck. The light is not stuck anywhere. And more importantly, it didn't get unstuck. You see that? The ego would say, yeah, that's great. We finally got light unstuck. This is a lie. Because if light can get stuck, then that must be part of reality. Then why would we want to free change reality? Is there just another way to say we just change reality? We got it unstuck. We changed what is. No, light has never been stuck. We're not getting it unstuck. or just seeing the nature of light, how it's always been, it's never been stuck. Cord was a little stuck, but the light isn't. Was the light in the cord that was stuck? Was the light stuck there too? The cord stuck, but is the light really stuck? I mean, the cord could turn into a planet if it wanted to, if we asked it to. The light will, whatever we want, the light presents. And so is it really stuck as a cord? Is there a stuckness we call the cord stuckness? Tree stuckness. Tree light stuckness. Hello, tree light stuckness. That's our perception telling us. We can just say, hello, tree light not stuckness. Not unstuckness. Not never stuckness. Hello, tree light never stuckness. Hello, cord light never stuckness. Hello, computer light never stuckness. Hello, glass light never stuckness. Hello, sunlight never stuckness. Hello, world light never stuckness. Hello, dirt light never stuckness. Hello, stone light never stuckness. Oh, I'm seeing the stone light never stuckness. How beautiful. The importance is to realize this is good enough. We've been, the ego's tricked us into thinking that, wow, you know, oh, good, you took that half step, but now take the final one, you know. No. That's what causes them to back off, say, wait a minute, I'm not ready for that final step. So then you back away from the half step, thinking that the half step is there in order for you to take this final step quickly. This is a lie. This is a seed of the ego. This is the nastiest trick I think there is. No, when you're experiencing this, hey, hello, tree light, unstuckness. No, I'm sorry, tree light never stuckness. See, I lost my concentration for a second, and the ego grabbed a hold of it. Hello, tree light never stuckness. Hello, tree light never stuckness. Hello, everything never stuckness. Everything light never stuckness. When we're experiencing that, that's all we need to experience. Perceptually, that's it. And we want to keep perception for now. So that's the ultimate in perception. So of course we're going to keep the ultimate perception. It's not that we have to take the other step. God will take that when we're fully, fully familiar with the qualities of reality. Where we have full confidence in light that it can never get stuck. Only when we're absolutely, you know, have the utmost assurance and confidence and familiarity with all this, then does God take the final step for us. So don't think, as soon as we start thinking, well, I need to go further, then we're going to avoid the avoidance. So we're going to avoid it. So all those are running around trying to get rid of the darkness, you know, that's ridiculous. Everything's vertical. The darkness is vertical, the running around is vertical, the light is vertical that we're seeing. Everything is vertical. Yeah, light itself is vertical. Even the light, the true light is vertical, you might say. Right? It's never stuck. It can never be stuck. And certainly the false light, the pretend light, that isn't stuck either. It's not stuck. The darkness, so-called absence of light is not stuck. It's vertical, all vertical. Hello, darkness, light, light of darkness, light of never stuckness. I'm seeing the darkness, light of never stuckness. Oh, now I'm seeing the electromagnetic light of never stuckness. Now I'm seeing the dark light of never stuckness. Now I'm seeing the computer light of never stuckness. Now I'm seeing the daylight of never stuckness. By the way, you can look at that video, Go Vertical. You can look at that on high def, actually. It's a high def video, so you can look at it full screen. It looks great. I mean, your computer's fast enough to, you know, show full screen. The newer computers, you know, are. You can watch it full screen. It's, the detail is just tremendous, you know. It's just really wow. What, 1080 HD? Very nice color. Very nice detail and clarity in the video. Absolutely. It's kind of cool to see that. I enjoy watching that video, actually. it's a good one. It's really, I said, wow, that Holy Spirit really put together something there. I didn't know what I was doing. I was just winging it, you know. And then the editing put it together. It edited it just, it seemed to edit it the right way. And it just came out really like a bowl of cherries. It's very cool. It's like art that works, you know. It's an expression. It works. It works. Did a lot of things right somehow. One of them, not being self-conscious, you know, and talking when I'm taking the video and make it talking this way. And people say, what the heck is he saying, you know? Go vertical. Why are you horizontal? Why are you stuck there horizontal? Why are you sitting on that rock horizontal? Go vertical. You know, people kind of say, huh? Yeah. But I look like a respectable enough person, you know. So I guess I just go for it, you know. You gotta dress nice and be very respectable when you start talking like that, when you're in public taking video. It's especially good when there's a lot of different tourists in different countries, because everybody blah, 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 blah. Everybody kind of just, you know, well, people just, I don't know what they're saying. They don't really care. They tune it all out after a while. It's very nice in touristy spots. I like that, because you say, oh, they're just a crazy tourist, you know. Maybe it's from Germany or something, you know. It just kind of, oh, yeah, that was crazy, crazy, you know, whether so-and-so's there, you know, they're talking to the stone there, I don't know why they're doing that, or talking to people, maybe they just do that in their country, I don't know. They just think you're a tourist. But if it's your friends, they're looking at you, what is the matter with you, you know? Oftentimes, friends get in the way, don't they? Big time. You know, I'm not a big fan of friends, actually, unless the friend might be Jesus, you know? I'm a big fan of Jesus as a friend, but otherwise, I'm not a big fan of friends. They tend to expect you to act in ways that...